The December of kit builds continues, and I'm starting off tonight with this Quiddy Vidi Cappuccino Stout from Quiddy Vidi Brewing in St. John's, Newfoundland. I think I'm going to need a strong beer with cappuccino in it for tonight's kit, because tonight's kit has a hell of a lot of soldering in it. This bag of LEDs here. Yeah, this is going to take some time. So this kit is known by a few different names online. I happen to get this one from Icy Station, and they call it Colorful LED Tower Display Rhythm Lamp Light with Infrared Remote Control Electronics DIY Kits Brain Training Toy Gifts. This is an imitation of the Guangzhou Tower in Guangzhou, China. So it's based on an STC-12C etc. etc. chip. And it is basically laid out as a 16 by 16 dot matrix display, though wrapped in a circle. There is the basic schematic of it. The chip just has a whole bunch of GPIO run out to the LED matrix, so rows and columns, essentially. The standard stuff that you need to run a microcontroller, a crystal and a couple of capacitors. There's some other LEDs down here. Couple of inputs, a push button. There's two major things going on. One is the software that runs it, which is supposed to be preloaded on the chip, which is good because I've never programmed an STC microcontroller before. And they say the default code inside the chip is more abundant, so please don't update it unless you have to. I'm good with that. And then the inventory, we'll just go through quickly what I've got to make sure that I have everything. There's the IC itself and socket. 2300 ohm resistors, that'd be these ones here that are in series with all the LEDs, 100k, 10k, a couple of caps, 4 or 5 millimeter LEDs, the crystal, USB, some round pins, I assume those are header pins, an infrared sensor, there's a self-locking switch and a button, some male or a male pin, and then 271 3 millimeter LEDs, colorful. I'm assuming that's the flashing or automatic color changing ones. We have a USB audio cable, some copper pillars, M3 standoffs, 10 millimeter, some M3 screws, a USB to TTL downloader. Oh, so they give you the tool to reprogram it if you want to. Neat. Some DuPont cables, a remote control, complete with battery. Woohoo! And 4 meters of cable. A circuit board, and an acrylic welding, aka soldering template. Then they have some LED processing. Okay, so that's for bending the LEDs to build the tower. And a downloadable manual. Nice. No doubt I will be referring to this manual throughout the build. 44 pages long. That is excellent. When was the last time you got something that detailed with a Chinese kit? So, there's the USB to serial programmer, kind of like the CH340 and other ones that I've got. There's some DuPont cables. I assume that goes with that. There is the LEDs. No, I'm not going to count them. I'm just going to assume this. What did they say? 270 some? There is the main circuit board. Good solder mask on it. Good labeling. Even though some of the labeling's in Chinese, I can live with that because there is enough English labeling on there. There is their welding or soldering template. It is actually clear acrylic, but it's got the paper on the top of it. So I think I'll leave the paper on it for now. There's no reason for that to be transparent acrylic. Remote control. USB mini on that end. USB A on that end and stereo audio. Okay. Some resistors. More resistors, another little capacitor. I think the inventory said there was two of those. There's that, what was it, 4 meters of wire. Push on, push off switch. Infrared receiver, momentary push button. Crystal, 11.0592 megahertz. There's the 5 millimeter LEDs and the standoffs and the screws and a single resistor. There is the IC and the socket. That's a neat way of shipping them. They've got them stacked pins to pins and then a bit of tape over them so they don't shift around and they don't get too badly mushed. Quality control. Female header pins, male 90s, a couple more 5mm LEDs, and the last of those. Let's take a look at these 5mm LEDs and just see. Okay, so those are the automatic color changing. So what are the 3mm LEDs? Fast, slow, and faster. So I guess that's how they get an awful lot of animation for not too much processing power. And then this thing, addressing the LED matrix, can turn any one of those on at any given time. Or multiplex it at very high speed. I guess all there is to it is to get to soldering. I'm going to start by populating the circuit board, which shouldn't take too long and should be a good warm-up for the main event, which is building a structure out of 200 plus LEDs. So one thing that I've noticed right away about this board is the components are all labeled, but they're labeled with the part number from the schematic. They're not labeled with their actual component value. So I'm going to be referring to that manual quite a bit.
For instance, the 10K is R22. So let's go find that on the board.
R22 is over there. Okay. And the 100K is R5, which is this one that's hiding down underneath the IC socket. That's an interesting way of doing it. And then the three capacitors are all the same, so they don't matter. C1, 2, and 3. And being ceramic capacitors, they're non-polarized, so that doesn't matter either. Put them in whichever way you feel like it. Some people like to see the labels all the same way. Me, I don't care. Let the soldering commence. And next is all the rest of the resistors, which are all 300 ohms. So 1, 2, 3, 4 there, and then a bunch there, and a bunch there. Times like this when I wish I had one of those fancy component lead benders. I suppose I could print one. A little late for that now for this project. There's the resistors all in. And zero apologies to the OCD people for doing that. Next is the crystal, and then the IC socket. Crystal just drops in there. I think I don't want to bend its leads, so I'm just going to hold it with some blue tack.
Next in is the IC socket, paying attention to where the notch is. The notch goes at the end away from the crystal. The notch indicates that pin 1 is over here.
So there's what it's talking about, the notch. There's a notch there on the silk screen. There's a notch there on the socket. And there's a notch there on the chip. Those all have to line up so that pin 1 is in the right spot. Throw a little strap of blue tack over that to hold it in place while I'm soldering it. What I'll do is I'll just solder two diagonal corner pins. That didn't take. And then I'll give it a push. Just a squeeze to make sure that the socket is seated down flat. There. Now I don't need this. And I can go ahead and solder the whole thing up. Okay, so I've just spun the board around 90 degrees to make it easier to get these switches in. Those mounting pins are kind of splayed out so that they hold themselves. That's nice. This one also has two mounting pins and then six electrical pins, so it is a double pull, double throw switch. Now it's going to take a bit of heat to get those mounting pins, and I think I'm going to start with those. They probably go into the ground plane plus. They're just on the metal body of the switch. Now then, the infrared sensor goes over there. So let me talk to it with the remote control. Not exactly sure what the remote control does. There is a part of the manual that talks about it though, so we'll deal with that when we get to it. Are we straight-ish? Yeah. What other components do we have to put on there? Oh yeah, those pins, right. Don't go like that. I think I want straight header pins in here rather than the 90s. Because that is the programming header. Yeah, I think I will use straight pins, and I'll just use some from my collection. That way we can get at them, and I can read them too.
Next step, install the 4 5-millimeter LEDs in the corners of the board. Pay attention to the direction.
Paying attention to the direction should be very easy because the flat spots are noted on there. The flat spots are always towards the inside of the board, and the flat spot is the negative side, aka the short lead. And as usual, solder just one lead on each one and flip the board over and just verify that they're all aligned properly. That looks about right. And I'll solder the other lead.
So the next step is install, test, and power. Okay. Check for the presence of weld. Make sure the components are installed correctly. Plug the chip in.
I don't see any shorted pads. Okay. I guess we can just install the chip, paying attention to get the notch at the right end. All in, nobody's bent. There it is, home. Now the pins look like they're bent over or under. All right, power. We use the little cable that they supplied. I'm going to power it from a power bank through my little horrible little charger doctor here. It's not a super precise thing, but it does the job. Okay, we got 5.16 volts. No current being drawn with it off. Power is on. Negligible amounts of current being drawn. Not even enough to keep the power bank alive. But those guys are all flashing. As they should be, because they're just automatically flashing LEDs. Onward to the time-consuming part. All these LEDs.
Installing the LEDs. So first we prepare the little jig here, and then it talks about how this thing's laid out. It's laid in 9 rings of 16 holes all the way around, and just goes from the first ring to the 9th ring, and then these center ones are special for the very tippy top spire of the tower. So all these LEDs have to be bent in a specific pattern, and all the same, all 200 and whatever there is, 270 some of them. So the negative, aka short leg, gets bent straight away, and the positive longer one stays straight up.
So like that. Then they just each go into their own hole on there, and then eventually we'll solder them into a ring with all the negatives in common. This part is why I wanted a beer with cappuccino in it, to keep me going. Because ultimately, I have to make 16 different rings for the 16 different layers. So I'm going to be at this part for a while. Okay, that's 16 LEDs all in a ring. Now it says to just trim off the excess from there. Just to tidy it up, I guess. Those are pinging all over the place. Hopefully none of them get into my beer. And there it is, a ring one of 16. So in order to keep these things straight, I've just made myself up some little tags to put on each one as I make them. And I'll figure out how to stack, or I'll worry about stacking them up later. But for now, I have to make a whole bunch more rings. I have to make a total of 16 rings. And just so I don't completely lose track, I've labeled the rings on there. And I've made myself a quick little chart of just how many I need of each one and which one they are. So I don't have to keep scrolling around in the manual. I'm not sure if there's a more efficient way to do these. Should I maybe pre-bin 16 of these at once? Maybe. But I'm not going to torture you, making you watch me do all 270 some of these LEDs. Okay, I got a couple more rings done, and I've sort of figured out a bit of a rhythm. I bend up a bunch of them and toss them into this convenient Altoids tin, or any convenient container, but that just happened to be what I have. And then throw the 16 of them on. But don't worry too much about getting them overlapping initially. Just get them in and then align them as you're soldering. That seems to be the most efficient way that I've found to do them so far anyways. I'm sure by the time I'm done the last one, I will have figured out something that I should have been doing hours and hours before, but whatever. This seems to be speeding the process up a little bit. And of course, I got background music on to just make the time pass faster. It's actually kind of relaxing to do once you get into the swing of it. So one thing I've discovered as I get closer and closer to the middle is I have to put more and more of a bend on these to get them to actually fit. And to get the last one in, I kind of have to pre-trim a couple of the leads, just so that I can swing them out of the way to drop that last one in. But I'm getting there. I'm over halfway now, so. And number 16, the last one. At least the last one of these big 16 LED rings, anyway. Now, the next thing to do is work on the parts for the spire. I'm really kind of impressed with this little template. It's the thing that makes this whole kit possible, basically. Without it, it would be even more difficult than what I'm making it look like right now.
And with all that soldered, I should have that mess on my workbench.
Which I kind of do. Nice. Oh, I should have mounted those LEDs lower. I'm going to make an artistic statement here. There. It was always supposed to be like that. I'm sure of it. So next, we fit in the first layer. The trick is getting all 16 of these nice flexible pins to align properly with the holes they're supposed to go into, without any others of them popping out. I think it's just a matter of going slowly around the circle, nudging them in one at a time while holding with the other side. There, that's all settled down into there. Now then, I don't want to have them all that far down, I don't think. Maybe I do. Getting the, putting all of the pins or the legs down right onto the cutting mat here lets me get them all pretty much aligned for height. I think I'll do that. And then chop them off afterwards, obviously. Yeah, that looks fairly parallel to the board, I think.
And now we connect all the layers together. So you have to bend the legs on all of the layers, except for the first one, inward a little bit like that, so that they can reach around onto the legs of the one below, like that.
And so in theory, you should be able to just tack these on here. I'm just going to tack every second or third one or fourth one around here initially.
I think I need this lightly held in the circuit board vise again just to get at everything.
That got them all? No, it doesn't. Miss this one. I think that's got it. Right, layer three and onward. Okay, there's four layers on. Let's see if it still works. Yeah, that looks like it's working as far as I can tell. All the columns seem to light up, although it happens very briefly, so it's hard to tell. Right, onward and upward. Time for layer eight. This is actually a little bit more repetitive and fiddly than putting the LEDs together in the rings themselves. But each time you get a ring on, it just looks more and more impressive. I'm getting better at doing that too. I only miss one or two now. Okay, there is the ninth layer on. So the next two are the same size. And then we start fanning back out again. As this thing gets taller, it becomes harder and harder for me to both get at it from a good angle to work on it, but also to film it. So I'm having to move my cameras to interesting and different angles. May or may not be good angles. I won't know until I get around to editing this. Did I get them all? I think so. Yep, that's sort of level. I think that's it. I've only got about that much space left between the top of this thing and my lights. I mean, it's not it. I've still got the spire parts to put on. So I am going to run out of height, and I'm not quite sure what I'm going to do about that.
So the spire is a little bit confusing. So the first layer of the spire has five LEDs in it, and that also gets connected to the vertical runs. But 5 doesn't divide by 16 perfectly, so they're saying... some have three pieces, some have two pieces spacing. There's a close-up of that picture, so looks like one goes onto this column, and there's one, two in between, and then that column, two between that column, two between that column, and three between. Okay.
So that goes in there, and I have to bend them out enough to get out to those columns there. Okay. The picture shows a fairly short bit there to make that happen. So let's do that. Just wheedle this into here somehow. There we go. I should have tinned those before I did that, shouldn't I? Oh well, whatever. I'll just make it work. And that looks fairly close to centered-ish. Okay, now the two stacks of three just go into there, I think.
This is a bit confusing. This definitely looks like it's going onto the vertical risers, but then this picture, it looks like it's going onto the horizontals. And this one has the ring of five going on to, yeah, I think these two one of these pictures is wrong. But this doesn't make sense, because that ring there is negative, and these verticals are all the positive leads of the LEDs. Yeah, see, the ring is negative, and that is a positive vertical. So that can't work if, like this. So I'm going to go with this picture and do that.
How do I do this? Yeah, okay, that'll work. And the next layer of three just goes on to those three, just like before, so that's easy-ish. Now then, I'm gonna have to resort to left-hand soldering again here. Big ugly bob, trying to move it around too much while it's cooling. I think that's it. Okay, so that is all the positive sides done. But I'm not finished, because there is still a wire to go from each of these horizontal rings down to these sets of pads down here. All right, I can't stand this up anymore. So with the kit, they supply all this really thin stranded wire, which is supposed to be used to run down to the bottom. And it's fairly thin, so it's going to be kind of invisible. But I think for up here, because I don't want to kind of strip out a bunch of little pieces, I think I'm just going to use a single piece of solid wire. That worked. And this one is already touching. That's good. There, top layer and the spire negative side all connected. And I think the next step, well, I'll check the manual to be sure, but I think it's just running these wires down to the base.
Yeah, here we go. Connect each layer of the tower main body to J17 to J32. First layer goes to J17, second layer goes to J18, and on all the way down, like that. So you end up with a whole bunch of wires running down the middle. I'm kind of glad they sent white wires rather than these red ones. They'll hide a little bit better in there.
That worked relatively well. And then solder it onto the layer. And repeat, and repeat, and repeat, and repeat, and repeat. So there's the first eight on there. And I've started to try and bundle them up a little bit just to make them neat and tidy. But there we are, up to the middle of the tower. Now the other eight go on to this set of pads. I'm not sure if I'll show you much more of this, because it's, again, repetitive, and it's really fine and hard to focus on with the camera. And here is the last wire for the top layer. What's proven to be the trickiest part of running these wires is hanging on to them up through the middle here. But with two pairs of tweezers, it's working out not too bad. Just have to go slow and careful. A little bit surgery-like. a little bit fly fisherman's fly tying like, but the job gets done. My soldering iron keeps going to sleep every time I do this because it takes a bit of time to get this up here. There we go. That should be the last wire soldered on. So now I guess all there is left to do is to test it and see how much soldering I screwed up here. I'm getting lights all the way to the top. Cool. Yeah. So it looks like the whole thing works. And what's it drawing? Very little, and it's changing too fast for me to see it on there. That's pretty nifty. Let me see if I can do anything better about the lighting in here. There, I'll use Big Clive's trick of locking the exposure. Now we can see it doing its thing.
So the website explains a little bit what the remote control does. Plus and minus increase and decrease the speed of the animation. These right and left arrows are for the music spectrum, animated play mode, switch to music spectrum mode, and 10 different animations.
I'm just going to quickly run through the patterns using the remote control. 2, 3, that's neat. 4, well, that's pretty cool. 5, 6, oh, it fills the tower. That's kind of neat. 7, 8, and 9, and then back to the default pattern. Okay, so this thing also has a music mode. So I've got my little MP3 player connected. I hit the menu button, which puts it into music mode. And there is one of the music reactive things. I think that's the maximum volume I can get out of my little MP3 player. But there are some different modes. You have more of a standard spectrum analyzer mode. A couple of different variants on that. And then this one from the middle, which I kind of like. Especially with the lower volume going on. So one final thing that I've done to this, I've gone and 3D printed a little base for it that I found on Thingiverse. I've got the name of it on there. That's pretty cool. It's got cutouts for all the things. There's the infrared receiver, the push buttons, and the USB port. I also had to flip these LEDs on the corners straight up. That's opposite from what the instructions say, but the instructions didn't expect you to come up with this little base piece here. So there it is in all of its glory. I hope you found that interesting. That was several evenings' work, as I'm sure you can tell by counting the various drinks that were in the corner of the shot. Questions and comments down below as usual. Thanks for watching. I'll talk to you later.